the Thoughty Autty podcast.
And also, like, with that intrusive piece that you're talking about, like, you know, before it was Asperger's and autism, right? They still were under an umbrella, right? But they were separated. Now, it's autism spectrum disorder. So I'm curious, from someone who has autism, you know, what that does for someone who's identified.
I think it's an interesting question. I know it's a very, there are some trigger points within the autistic community, and a lot of the trigger points tend to be around what we call functioning labels.
Like high functioning autism or whatever. Yeah.
And basically the Asperger's label was created by Hans Asperger, who, so sort of a researcher in Vienna. They owned this really, really great children's hospital at the time, and it was taken over by sort of the Nazis during the Second World War. And basically he made the distinction between two groups of people. One which he called Asperger's Syndrome, which were people he deemed to be sort of useful to society. Usually tend to be, obviously there's social awkwardness sort of on the outside to them, but more of the hyperfixation, the sort of the more intelligent ones. Mm-hmm. And sort of he boxed those people off so that they weren't removed. I won't go into too much about that, but so there's a bit of history around that. And, you know, we have a lot of issues in the autistic community, like fears around eugenics, which has been, you know, it's only in the last sort of 10 odd years where it's kind of been challenged in some sort of some organizations. So there's that kind of split. And I think a lot of people will respond quite drastically to things like that, because they, you know, they were very sort of quick to kind of identify that and sort of separate ourselves from the label. For me, it's quite a bit more complicated, because I see the utility of having sort of set categories of people based on which needs they have. I think for a lot of people, it's just the terminology. It's like, it's not nice to be called
what makes you someone high functioning or low functioning. Exactly. It's not like you have high functioning ADHD and low functioning ADHD.
Well, it's not nice for someone to call you low functioning, because, you know, what are you trying to say?
Right.
And it's not nice for someone to call you high functioning, because you may have loads of issues, but be considered high functioning, and people don't take you seriously, you don't get as many supports, you don't get as many adjustments. So, you know, that both of those terms, they kind of they box people off based on you know, what their needs and their functioning levels, which is not something that people like to draw a lot of attention to.
Sure.
And, you know, for me personally, it's something that I've, you know, thought about quite a lot. There's different ways of saying it nowadays. I think it's more about categorizations, but whenever I try to kind of think about or have a dialogue around sort of the utility of those kind of categorizations, it's almost always like a really hot point of, you know, people saying like, how dare you? You're an ableist. You're saying that we're better than them and stuff like that. But then you have the parents of autistic people or friends or supporters of autistic people who have like intellectual disabilities. Mm-hmm. They can't manage a job, they can't live by themselves, you know, they have all these supports in place, they can't communicate sometimes. So there's that tension around making that distinction, which can often kind of shut down a lot of conversations around those things.
Which then I'm so wondering, like, now that people don't use the term Asperger's, right? So now
It's ASD 1, 2, and 3, which is basically, right. I think it's worse for the cause, because because you're literally saying, like, what level of autism do you have in 1, 2s, and 3s, which right. I don't think that's a good way of doing it, but
right.
Yeah, it's a very complicated.
You know what? With ADHD,
word.
There's mild, moderate, and severe. So mm-hmm. I guess that's your 1, 2, and 3. But it's not indicative of intellectual ability.
Yes.
It's just the amount, like how prominent mm-hmm. the ADHD is. So
I think for me, I tend to make the distinctions because I tend to make the distinction based on if or not they have an intellectual disability. So I just say they're autistic and they have intellectual disability, which kind of, you know, we're not talking about levels of autism, but we're talking about autism and a different diagnosis.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of hard walking that line. I think, you know, one thing that I'd be really interested in knowing is around the sort of the particulars around identity and language before we sort of wrap up, because
yes,
I find it really interesting because, I mean, for you, you've been sort of using that person
individuals
first language.
With yep, and in
yeah,
the UK
individuals
it's opposite.
With.
And if you say that in the US, it's offensive.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, I think in terms of autism, the consensus is for autistic adults is that a lot of us like, well, I just said it, a lot of us like to be identity first, like, and that it's weird because people who prefer one use of a language versus another, like they both have sort of positive intentions with it. Like the person first language is like, oh, person first, like of course we want to put the person first, that's great. They're different from this. They're better than this. And whereas when you have the identity first, it's like, well, you don't want to box someone off into a category. But I think that the real sort of difference is the attitude in terms of identity, because if you view autism in sort of a neutral to positive way, and you see it as part of your being. And you don't feel like if you went autistic, if you feel like you wouldn't be your same person if you didn't have an autism diagnosis. And it's something that I feel for myself. But then I do understand sort of, it tends to be sort of with the more person first language, it's something that's been used quite a lot in the world of education and parenting. So mm-hmm. It's kind of been adopted for a different reason, but it's all in the positive intentions of
absolutely.
Using that. So it's interesting that like crossover between, but what about ADHD? Because I know
individuals
that
with
some
ADHD. Yeah. It's the same. Yeah. It's the same difference with the UK and the US with the autism and ADHD. So I had this conversation with another podcaster in the UK and coming from a school background, we had to be very careful how sure. we identified someone with a disability. So even on an individual education plan, which is a legal binding document with services and accommodations, it's an individual with autism,
that,
an individual yeah. with ADHD,
mm-hmm.
an individual with depression, an individual with anxiety. It's not an anxiety person or an ADHD person or an autism
well, I think
person.
It's
right?
interesting those crossovers. Like I've talked right. to people with like physical disabilities and, you know, they don't want to be called physically disabled
person.
They want to be called a person with a physical disability.
Disability, right. But
in terms of like the ADHD community sort of outside of education, outside of those kind of systems, do you think that ADHD is sort of prefer that person first language or that kind of identity first language?
I think it depends where they're from.
That's fair enough.
So if they're from the UK, they're used to doing the identity first. If from the US, they are used to doing I mean, and some people are more sensitive to the labels than others, mm-hmm. you know? just like ADHD and autism. It's a spectrum, right? So everyone responds differently to labels, I think.
Yeah. I think it's generally consensus that identity first is preferred by a lot of autistic people, but
yes. And some people don't understand labels too. Some people without the diagnosis or even with the diagnosis, you know, they'll say, why do you need to label it?
Yeah.
You know, nothing happens in vacuum, which is true, right? So everything is nature and nurture. However, you know, it helps individuals usually to be more self-aware and be able to, you know, come from a place of strengths within their diagnosis as well, right? Like everyone has strengths, just, you know, human strengths that they have based on their core strengths and their core values. But then there's also typical strengths of individuals with autism and individuals with ADHD. So knowing those and knowing your boundaries with weaknesses can help you thrive with a diagnosis too.
It's very interesting. I mean, it's for me, it's, you know, I like to be referred to as an autistic person, but I'm also like, but only in the case of like, you know, if someone was to put a media piece out, I would prefer that they say Thomas is an autistic person rather than Thomas has autism, Thomas with autism, just as a personal preference. But I know that a lot of people can be very, they can find that kind of difference in language very, very difficult to navigate for themselves. They can get quite upset if people use the wrong sort of terms for it.
So,
but to be honest, the majority.
That's interesting. As someone, sorry.
It's okay.
You go.
I think the majority of people, they don't mind either way. They saw most people use it interchangeably. It's just kind of what fits with the sentence that you're saying. But I know that it is kind of it has been a talking point in the past. Definitely.
So yeah, I'm curious, right? So you have autism, I have ADHD. So you're from the UK, I'm from the US. So when I identify you in a conversation, right? Would I say you're an autistic individual because, right, you're autistic. And then when you talk to me, are you going to say,
ADHD.
I have
that's,
ADHD.
That's why I was kind of like, do I call you an ADHD-er? Do I say with autism?
Right.
Yeah.
PC.
I don't know if it is a sort of a regional thing. But
meanwhile, I call myself an ADHD-er all the time. It's just easier for me rather than dragging it out an individual with ADHD. And in my social media and in my newsletters, I very often use ADHD. And I've had some people, even from the US or the UK, who've been offended by the word ADHD. So you just don't know.
It's interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think the consensus is that I know a lot of people like the identity first for autism, but I think it's always just good to go by what the individual wants to use.
Exactly. Like if I want to change my name. Exactly. Yeah. If I want to change my name from Brooke to Beth, you're going to call me Beth, not Brooke. If you want to be called, you know, an autistic person, then I'm going to call you an autistic person or autistic. Right.
Yeah.